Torco seemingly is calling out the amount of people who perished that day before the body count was actually tallied up.
The three had been hitchhiking home near the West Bank and were never heard from again.
Capture Israelis, massacre Israelis, drug them. Take some of them back. No doubt extort ransoms or kill some of them when they get them back to their territory.
As a boy, I spent several years in Indonesia and heard the call of the azan at the break of dawn. Let there be no doubt, Islam is a part of America.
Darkness is when you don't see things, you don't understand what is going on.
Right.
How they could tell you what is going on.
As religion becomes so steeped in dogma and ritual that we no longer believe that miracles could exist.
Hi, this is Richard Shaw. I'm the director of the Torah Code film called End to Darkness. And a lot of folks have had questions since then about the Torah Codes that weren't answered in that film. So this is an attempt to do that and also to show some of the more recent codes that have to do with the return of the Messiah and also about Donald Trump, which I thought everybody might be interested in. Let me just clarify a few things here. First of all, the codes are not a religion. They're basically completely mathematical. They're not satanic. They have nothing to do with that. They're not only for Jewish people. They're not supposed to be used as a crystal ball to predict the future. And they're not a way to ignore regular biblical prophecy in the uncoded text. So let's get that out of the way first. The codes are based on mathematics. They are found using computer software. They're supernatural in their existence, meaning that we couldn't have done this ourselves. We don't have the technology to do something this sophisticated. It could be a possible preview of the Book of Life. We've had people ask about that. It's a possibility. It's proof that the Torah was a gift from God to help us deal with future issues when we were smart enough to discover it. That is our generation. We have the equipment now to dig some of these codes out, and there's always new things being found and also new ways of dealing with finding codes. This kind of bears out in a scripture in Proverbs that says, "It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter." Well, that's what we're trying to do. I'm going to tell you a little bit of inside stuff. I want to tell you how I got into this because it is kind of a bizarre thing to be studying, and I was really fascinated with it. We're going to show how the codes actually work. I'm going to show you some of the best tables that I have, and then also at the end we'll show you the Trump tables. In 1998, I was working in Beverly Hills on a TV pilot at the Beverly Hilton. There was a guy on a morning TV talk show, could have been morning, Good Morning America, by the name of Michael Drosnin. Drosnin had written this book called The Bible Code. And through that book, which I read on the plane flying back to Atlanta, I learned about Professor Rips and the codes after reading that book. I was really impressed with what I'd read about Professor Rips, never thinking I'd ever get to meet the guy. Let alone all of the other Bible code experts, because they were all in Jerusalem and I was in Los Angeles. So it seemed rather unlikely. But I guess you could say God had other plans. What's very interesting, and this is New Testament, and my Orthodox friends don't use the New Testament in the Bible. In Acts chapter 7, verse 53, it says, "You who have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it." This was basically when Stephan was being about to be stoned, and gave the rabbis there kind of a rundown historically of a bunch of things that had happened, and including the Torah. And basically stated that the Torah had been given through angels. Now, who are angels? It's debatable. You could say that they're heavenly creatures or heavenly beings. Or today, if we saw an angel, would we say it's an alien? I don't know. Because of our training and upbringing, we might have a little more insight than they did several thousand years ago when the Torah was given over 3,300 years ago. The way it happened for me was a very strange coincidence. This guy here is one of my best friends. His name is Lee Cantillon. At the time I had a studio in Hollywood, Lee came over one afternoon and we got to talking. This is what the studio looked like. This was Pinlight in Hollywood. This was the front room, and actually this was the second floor of the Matt Sennett stage where Charlie Chaplin used to rehearse way back in the silent film era, and this is the second floor of that building that we basically remodeled. In the back where you can see the door opening was an Avid editing suite. And so Lee and I sat in this room and talked about what might be interesting to do. And I said, you know, I don't know, but the Bible code fascinates me. I don't understand how it works. I'd like to know more about it, and I'd like to do a film about it. And I said, if I did it, I'd like to go to the actual source, which are the rabbis that figured all of this stuff out, and talk to them. But I said, you know, I have no idea how that would ever happen. And the two of us were already working on another project at the time. I was finishing deliverables for a movie called Beat the Drum, and Lee was working with Ricky Lee Jones and was about to leave to go on a trip to Japan, basically to produce one of her concerts there. Well, when he gets back, he decides to visit his brother Paul, who lives in New York City at the time. Paul is a music composer and writes music for movies. So he gets on JetBlue and they cancel the flight because of bad weather. So they ask him to come back in a couple days, which he did. Weirdly enough, it put him on a seat assignment with a guy on this second trip on JetBlue in a seat that just basically was assigned to him. He ends up sitting by this guy who looked like a rabbi. This man was Professor Robert Herelick from City University in New York. The two of them started talking, and Lee began to understand that Professor Herelick was one of the guys who was working on writing the code, the algorithms to search the Bible code, and knew all of the world experts, and they're all were his best friends. And so they talked for 5 hours on the plane as they were flying back to LaGuardia. So Lee basically tossed him his phone when they landed, and I was connected with the whole group. It was really kind of amazing. I don't understand it. The chances of this happening are 1,000,000 to 1. There's also another kind of code called gematria, and this is where each letter in the Hebrew text is assigned a number. It's always been this way, but what they do, they add these up and they get numbers out of them. And we thought this was really interesting. Like you can see here, like the first one, the big long sentence adds up to 776, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is what that says. The next line says, the kingdom of David in the world forever. All these add up to 776. And then at the bottom one, it said the coming of Messiah in 776. Well, we thought at the time that meant 5776. Which would have been the year 2016. Well, it didn't happen, even though all of these sentences were quite significant, and there were so many of them, it really kind of was interesting. In fact, Tom Horn, who's a really good author, wrote a book called Zenith 2016 that year because he also found so many things that had happened during that year. We all wondered what it meant. We still don't know. There is this theory that it's a possibility that the Hebrew calendar is actually off by a year or two because of the flood when they couldn't do accurate calculations, but we don't know. This next little piece of video is from the movie Pi, and you need to see this.
Hey, Max, Lenny Meyer. Sorry, put it out. So, what do you do?
I work with computers, math.
Math? What kind of math?
Number theory, research mostly.
No way, I work with numbers myself. I mean, not traditional. I work with the Torah. Amazing! You know, Hebrew's all math. It's all numbers. You know that? Yeah, look. The ancient Jews used Hebrew as their numerical system, eh? Each letter's a number. Like the Hebrew A, Aleph, it's one. B, Bet, it's two. You understand? But look at this. The numbers are interrelated. Like, take the Hebrew word for father. Av, Aleph, Bet. One, two, equals three. All right? Hebrew word for mother, aim, Aleph, Mem, 1, 40, equals 41. Sum of 3 and 41, 44. All right? Now, Hebrew word for child, all right? Mother, father, child, Yelad. That's 10, 30, and 4, 44. Torah is just a long string of numbers. Some say that it's a code sent to us from God.
That's kind of interesting.
Yeah, that's just kid stuff. Check this out, okay? The word for the Garden of Eden, Kedem. Numerical translation, 144. Now, the value of tree of knowledge, all right, in the garden, right? Eitz HaChayim, 233. 144, 233. And you can
those
take those numbers.
So, the, you know, like the Fibonacci sequence?
Fibonacci
is an Italian mathematician in the 13th century. If you divide 144 into 233, the result approaches theta.
Theta?
Theta. The Greek symbol for the golden ratio, the golden spiral.
Wow. I never saw that before. Just like that series you find in nature? Like the face of a sunflower?
Wherever the spirals.
You see this math everywhere.
I love that clip where he just freaks out when he realizes that the Torah's basically got all of the codes, even in the physical space we live in. It's pretty amazing. Professor Ripps did a Torah code table based on the Fibonacci number sequence that we just saw. This is it. I mean, it's all in a very tiny little table. All of the codes for the sequence are in there. It's just wanted to show you that. Basically, the codes deal with something called equidistant letter sequencing. Now, there's an example there on the screen. It says, this is the form we use for finding codes. And basically, it's saying that he's trying to make a longer example here. But what he ended up with was a row that says the word order. That's kind of the way that the Torah codes work. You basically find a skip code, how many letters you're skipping, and the computer finds those words and displays them as columns of text. So the man that figured this out was Rabbi Weissmandel. And the way he discovered it was that he discovered that if he went skipped every 50 letters, starting with the letter Tet, in the book of Genesis, it spelled out the word Torah and did the same thing in the book of Exodus. It didn't work in Leviticus, so he thought he'd try 8 letters, and he ended up with the word Hashem, which is all there the Hebrew word for God. So he thought he would try that in the book of Numbers, and he skipped every 50 letters again and got the word Torah backwards. And then he tried it again in Deuteronomy and it, with 50 letters, and it didn't work. And he goes, oh, that's right. Moses wrote the book of Deuteronomy, so he doesn't get the perfect number 50, so we'll try every 49 letters. And sure enough, the word Torah was in there backwards. So basically, you end up with Torah, Torah, God, Torah, mirror image, Torah, mirror image. It's very weird and more than coincidence. And that's just counting with his fingers, no computer. There's also something called resonance. People say, oh, they're forcing the words into horizontal and vertical rows and diagonal and all that. And no, actually, that is a natural physical occurrence that happens. And I'm going to show you this video that someone put up on YouTube. And this is it. It's basically, he made a plate that's connected to a sine wave generator, sprinkling salt on there, turns up the frequency, and patterns just form magically from vibration. This is on the YouTube channel, youtube.com/BrustPup. It's at the bottom of the screen if you want to see the whole thing. I thought it was really cool and basically shows at different frequencies and at different skips in the Torah is why you get these letters going backwards, forwards, vertically, horizontally, sideways. It's because of the frequency that they're in. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about the world experts. That happens to be my friend Rabbi Glazerson. Professor Eliyahu Rips is most credited for being the discoverer of the Torah codes on computer. He got everybody excited about it. He has a long history of working with the Torah. And when he was basically a teenager, was living in Czechoslovakia, and he was a mathematician, and the Soviets invaded, and to protest, he set himself on fire at Freedom Square. Horrified onlookers came up and put him out, and they took him to a psychiatric prison for a couple years, Russia. And he was finally released, and some mathematicians got him together and got him to Israel. And he gets there and he sees all these rabbis wearing crazy clothes, didn't know what they were doing or why, and started studying the Torah and felt like, you know, if there really is something to this, then I should be able to find something within the book itself. And that's when he started searching for some kind of numerical description in the Torah. And it was another rabbi that he met by the name of Yaniv. Rabbi Yaniv gave him a book from Weissmandel, and that got Professor Rips wondering if it were possible to use a computer, and Rabbi Yaniv had already done some simple tests with it and was successful. So Professor Rips got together with two other gentlemen, Doran Whitstam and Yoav Rosenberg at the time. This was way back in the late 70s, and wrote the first Torah code search application, and that's how it all started. And since then, it's gotten a lot more sophisticated. Professor Robert Herrlich is an expert on statistics, has an incredible background in technical areas. He had worked at one point in the space program, figuring out how to compress data that was coming back from satellites. So this was like pre-JPEG compression. This was something that Professor Herrlich worked on with a couple other guys and figured out how to compress the signals coming back from satellites so they could see clearer images. This is kind of the mind that Professor Herrlich has. Since then, he's been doing a lot more than that, and he basically is a computer expert, teaches computer science at City University in New York. This is Rabbi Matityahu Glazerson, who has become a Torah code expert and is kind of thinks way outside the box sometimes, but I really like Glazerson a lot because of that. And he's found some incredible tables, and a lot of it is because he has how things were worded in ancient Hebrew and looks for codes in that original language, which hardly anybody else I know can do. So that's Rabbi Glazerson. He's a terrific guy and has an incredible amount of knowledge, and we've had fascinating discussions together and still do. This is Professor Alexander Rotenberg. Rotenberg is an amazing guy. He wrote the Torah code search software that we use today, the ones that shows the codes like a crossword puzzle, was his idea. Came up with it in the late 80s, I believe. And it has changed just a little bit since then, but it was basically his brainchild. He's a graduate of Moscow University in mathematics. He's a brilliant guy, very soft-spoken, very humble. It was a pleasure to meet him a few years ago at his apartment in Jerusalem. This is Art Levitt, who really takes after Professor Rips. He's a real stickler on getting everything correct in the codes. If it's not done right or to his satisfaction, he calls them average or normal and wants to make sure that they all have good p-values. That is basically as scientifically accurate and as perfect mathematically as possible. It's something that Professor Rips also does. And I think Professor Rips, out of all of the researchers I know, has made some of the most incredible tables of all, but Art Levitt has done some really fascinating ones as well. Now, here are a few of my favorite tables that I'm going to show you, just because they're unique and interesting. We're not trying to offend anybody here with some of the content of these tables. They are very much centered around Israel, a lot of them. So I'm going to show you what we have. This was one that Rabbi Glazerson came up with, and it was basically about our film, and it comes out in the Torah codes. The codes will be distributed, and it has my name in there, basically in parallel rows and close together with small skips, which is pretty significant. Don't ask me why that's in there, but it is. It even has the correct year. 5775, which was 2015 when the film was released. It has Glazerson's name in. His first name is Matityahu. It's in there. Talks about the doctrine of Messiah. And in the plain text, near where this code sequence was found, it says, "Your eyes which see the deeds of God." I always thought that was kind of cool. This is a table from Art Levitt back when Saddam Hussein was captured and killed. What's interesting about this, to show you how such a tiny table can contain so much information, I'm going to bring it in stages for you so you can see this. Saddam will die. Saddam will die, and he was hanged. And you notice how tightly together these codes are. He was hanged like his brother, and the "like his brother" is intertwined with the word "hanged." It's pretty amazing. George Norrie, who is the host of Coast to Coast AM, we did some tables for him that were pretty amazing. And Professor Rips did this one, several tables that were done over almost a three-week period. This one really is quite phenomenal because it really talks about George Norrie. If you've ever listened to Coast to Coast AM, you know it's all about UFOs and the paranormal and all of that, and yet George is very level-headed about it. And what's interesting is that Professor Rips found a whole sentence about George using George's name. It says, "Loves the paranormal, but clear-cut." That's basically George Norrie. I know George personally, and that's the way he is. He's very clear-cut about it. Crossing that sentence is the word "radio." And then parallel to it is the word "broadcaster." And Norrie is in green. I mean, it's quite amazing. The next table is... the reason I'm putting it up here is because everything was slanted at the same level and repeated in the codes and in the plain text besides. So it was very hard to ignore this, even though it's not the most popular tables for liberals. Basically, it has the words Hillary and Obama intertwined at the same angle. It says, "What is their heart?" It says, "United States." The United States has been defiled. And then it says, "The abomination unto the Lord," in the Torah codes in red at the same angle in the same sentence. Now, at the bottom of this table in black with yellow letters, it says, "An abomination unto the Lord thy God," which is actually in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 17, verse 1, which basically is the same thing that the codes say in this same passage. You can study the rest for yourself, but I mean, as crazy as this table is, I felt that it was significant because you don't see tables like this every day. This is a really recent table. I mean, this one's like kind of shouting us at us. It has everybody's name that's been involved in the Torah codes in some way in one sentence. It's a little messy, but basically it says Matityahu, which is Rabbi Glazerson's first name, code there at the bottom, the code, 5779, which is the year 2019, this year. 5736 is the year where the codes were first discovered by Professor Rips. Rips is right under it. Code of Messiah. And then it has my name, Richard. And then my company name, Pinlight, parallel at the same angle. I mean, don't ask me how that happened. The word faith and in the Torah and from heaven and Daron. Daron Woodstom is one of the code researchers that helped write the software. I mean, all this stuff is in this one table. Here's another one kind of like that. This one I like a lot. This was done by Rabbi Glazerson. He did it for me. I didn't ask him to do it, but he did this and gave it to me. It says, the code of Messiah and Pinlight, with the word ephod just above it. We think that the ephod might have been a computer. It's very possible because of the lights that would come off and on to answer questions that it was some kind of very high-tech device. The keywords in the middle say Torah code, and it has the years, 5736. That was the year that the code was discovered, and then 5775 was the year our film came out. And then down in the plain text it says, we'll show to the world the deeds of God. That's kind of a cool table. To show how the plain text works with actual text, this is one of my favorite tables. This is about the Twin Towers. It says at the top of the page, Twins, Towers, Massacre, September 11th, the terror attack. And then right beneath all of that cluster of codes highlighted, it says, and fell from the people this day about 3,000 men. And if I remember right, it was like 2,997 people died that day. And that's what the scripture said 3,300 years ago. So that's an incredible table. This is another one. In Jewish tradition, the word Samael, which is in this, it's the desolation of God or the left hand. So this is kind of a problem that the left has, always going against things. In this table is the word Kavanah and blame, hatred, and a feminine plot, which we pretty much discovered that was the case. Most of the women that said that Kavanah abused them have recanted. It was a feminine plot to try to not get him into his position as Supreme Court Justice. This is another one. This was found by Professor Herlich and Rabbi Glazerson. This was when Breitbart died in 5772, which is 2012. Comes up in the codes, was poisoned on the 1st of March and will be killed. Indeed, that's what most people believe happened to him. Everybody was concerned with 2012. We were studying that 2012 codes way back in 2009. And what I thought was interesting about this, Rabbi Glazerson found this table. The keywords, the axis keywords are change in the world. And it says on the 10th of Tevet, which is December 22nd, 2013. So basically, there's some overlap here of dates because in the Hebrew calendar, 2013, you're already in 2013 in the month of December. Not for us, but for them you are. So indeed, we've had a lot of changes that have happened since 2012. The world has changed. This is probably Professor Rip's most famous table. He looked this up right after the Twin Towers attack. It's the Twin Towers airplane attack. Those letters came up. All in chapter 20 of the Book of Numbers in just a very small table, an amazingly small table. And the chances for this to come up are millions to one, that all of those words would be so tightly configured in just one chapter.
Rest.
Many, many pages are just empty. But when we came to chapter 20 of this book, then all of them suddenly appear in one place. This shows very clearly how everything concentrated in one single place.
All right, so that is basically showing that this, what we did, I asked Professor Herlich if he could do some monkey text for me, or essentially to see if he could find the same words that Professor Rips did in another text. And sure enough, he did. But as you can see, here's the first example, 4,488 letters in it. And that's really just kind of random and doesn't mean anything. It's insignificant. In Professor Rips' original table, the whole table was only 234 letters. Here's another one that we discovered. This was in a table that ended up having 7,772 letters. It had all of the same names, but the skips were enormous. So it's basically forcing a table to say what Professor Rips found mostly in the Book of Numbers. This is a Planet X table. If you know anything about Planet X, there is this idea that Planet X Nibiru is going to appear. We don't know when, but the Torah codes seem to predict it. And in Jewish mystical texts, it talks about Planet X quite a bit, and there's a lot of people studying it right now. No one's seen it yet, but we think that it might have had something to do with the flood of Noah and other things that happened through history. There's researchers like Marshall Masters and also Gil Broussard have done insane amounts of work studying this and comparing it to historical references. But what's interesting about this, it says, in the end of days, Nibiru, it has it all spelled out in very tight form, a warning in 5776, and a lot of people were talking about Planet X in 2016, and basically a threat. Here's another one, a little bit different. But in the actual plain text, it says, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. And this is out of Breaking Israel News. After 40 days, when the pillar rises from earth to heaven in the eyes of the whole world, and the Messiah has appeared, a star will rise up on the east, blazing in all colors, and seven other stars will surround that star, and they will wage war on it. Now, this is basically in Jewish mystical texts. And there was a guy who tried to claim that he was the Messiah 400 years ago, and because this planet didn't appear, they didn't believe him. What's interesting, in the New Testament, Jesus says that there will be a sign of the coming of the Son of Man, and then the Son of Man comes. Some people believe that sign is an astronomical sign. Here is that scripture in Matthew 24. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. Didn't that sound like some kind of major astronomical event? And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. This is Gil Broussard's graphic, which is quite amazing, that shows that all of the planets in our solar system are experiencing change, climate change, if you want to call it that. And they're visible from telescopes. Like, if we go through the whole thing, I mean, if you freeze this and read it yourself, it'd be better than me going through all this and boring the heck out of all of you. But basically, there are changes going on in our solar system that's affecting all the planets, not just the Earth. What we're experiencing is not due to carbon being emitted on the Earth, because then why is it that the planet Venus is now 2,500% brightness increase There's no cars on the planet Venus, but it's changing too. This is a table from Michael Drosnin's book, The Bible Code, page 155, which was released in 1997. There was a comet that everybody heard about. It was called Comet Elenin, and it was they thought it would pass by the Earth. Now, we didn't know that there'd be a comet in the year 2012 that would pass by the Earth back in 1997. No one knew about that. But the Torah codes did, and in Drosnin's book it says, Comet, it will be crumbled. I will tear it to pieces in 2012. I sent that table to Rabbi Glazerson and Dr. Rotenberg. They did this table. It had the word Elenin in the table. It says, to be finished in 5772, which is 2012, Nibiru will break broken the comet star, and then kind of ominously down in the lower left corner in the plain text, it says, in the end of days. Unbelievable. Here's actually from space.com, a news item. Doomsday comet Elenin zips by the Earth in pieces. So there's the physical proof of it happening. Sometimes things are in the Torah codes that we have actual physical proof later that they were true. Just like we have in this, in the torn Torah scroll in Mumbai. We've showed this before, but when the terrorist fired into the Shabbat house, the Torah was damaged and ripped a hole right in this particular passage. In that passage where the hole was ripped in the Torah, it says, massacre terror in the Shabbat house in Bombay. All of this, these codes were found in that little space that was ripped out by the machine gun bullet. Incredible. Professor Rips did this table, which is pretty also pretty famous. It says, destruction I will name you, cursed is bin Laden, and revenge belongs to the Messiah. Well, everybody knows what happened to bin Laden. I just thought that this table is more than coincidence. It has an enormous sentence that basically all is butted up against itself. So let's go into the Trump codes here. Is President Trump in the Torah codes? Yes, he is. You may have heard of Trump being compared to King Cyrus and all of that. So let's see what the Torah codes say about him. Here we have a pretty involved table that has all of the issues. Iran, Cyrus, Messiah, the agreement, Donald Trump, president, in 2018, and basically the agreement will be canceled. That's basically true. Another one, in the second month of the Hebrew calendar, Donald Trump is encoded. Chess fan, which is November 8th when he was elected. Lover of Israel, which is true. Made the change that Jerusalem would be the capital of Israel. To the U.S., the president will be elected. All this was in the Torah codes and found before it happened. Another one on Donald Trump, and the word Cyrus is in there. You have to understand that King Cyrus was the king who basically brought the Jews back into their homeland and allowed them to build another temple. Everybody's wondering if Trump is going to help them build the third temple. We don't know if that's going to happen or not, because there'd be a lot of political things involved, but a lot of people are hoping that. What's also interesting is that Trump is the 45th president of the United States. If you go to Isaiah chapter 45, that chapter talks about King Cyrus, who everybody refers Trump to King Cyrus. The idea that it's in the 45th chapter and mentions, and Trump is like basically in all the codes, along with the word Cyrus, is why they minted a coin in Israel with both of their heads on it. King Cyrus and Donald Trump. Which also is kind of interesting is Gematria for Donald Trump in the first Torah code table was found by Rabbi Matityahu Glazerson. The Paris conference that Trump went to is 777, comes up to that number. The date of Trump's inauguration was 1-20-17. Trump's birth was on 6-14-46, which is 70 years, 7 months, and 7 days from his birth, or 777. and the Hebrew year is 5777, which is 2017. I mean, it's really crazy, but that's what it says. We also were concerned about Donald Trump being assassinated. Professor Ripps made this table, and it says the name of his assassin. Well, so Rabbi Glazerson happened to be in Los Angeles, and I said, we need to see if we can search the codes and see if there's a name for this guy. And so Rabbi Glazerson did this new table with the name of the murderer and Donald Trump, and a guy's name Michael came up in 5776, which was 2016. The threat of a murderer, the murderer. What's interesting is this guy, when Trump was in Las Vegas, grabbed one of the security guard's pistol and tried to shoot Trump with it, and his name was Michael Sanford, and he was arrested. This is the same guy jailed over plan to shoot Donald Trump. And then, of course, we've had all these crazy things happen, which I think are really quite despicable and not funny at all. Kathy Griffin's beheading, the sick joke with Donald Trump's head. If they'd done this to Obama, can you imagine the outrage? And then people holding signs up, rape Melania. It's just really sick. But that's the way our society has become. I think it's disgusting. We're talking now about the whole Hillary and Trump situation. So Professor Ripps did a couple tables for me and sent them to me. I didn't know he was going to do these, but I think you should see them. He did a table on the Clinton Foundation and Hillary. They're basically all in a straight line. Hillary Foundation really corrupted.
The Comey covers up table. That's really, really incredible.
Exactly. Yeah, no doubt. You see, so therefore, you see the importance of this cause. You see, so many words related. You understand?
When Professor Ripps sent me the table on Comey and Hillary, I thought it was a good table. Here were parallel rows of sentences all describing what happened, a news item that we're all familiar with. But I was astonished when I began to study the skips that made up this table. It went well beyond anything I'd ever seen before. Here we have Comey covers up with a skip of 513 characters. Then over one line and parallel with it is For the Mail, also with the same skip of 513. Then above these two lines, and printed horizontally with a skip of only two characters, is the word Hillary. The final cluster is the most amazing. Two sentences come together on their own, on the same line, each with a skip of the same 513 characters. The sentences, making use by their foundation. In all, there is a complete story here. Comey covers up For the Mail, making use by their foundation. Sharing these same characters and splayed out over those sentences about the foundation, in 3D if you will, is the word servers. Compact beyond belief, but then I had to gasp when I realized that the word servers had a skip of 1,539 characters. If you multiply 513, the size of the skip for the other sentences, by 3, you get 1,539 characters.